Hello to our Good News Club teachers. We are jumping back into our Moses lesson series, God's Power to Escape from Egypt, lesson two. So get ready. Most likely, if you're on the same schedule with the San Fernando Valley chapter of the Good News Clubs, you have had a long Christmas vacation and your kids may have forgotten the story of Moses that we started right before the break. So we're definitely going to do some review today, and then we have a lot of story packed in to our lesson today, but there's also a lot of great messages for us as adults and for those kids. So welcome your kids to Good News Club. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. We're so glad you guys decided to come back to Good News Club. Every single kid I see here, you made a great choice. You decided to come today to start off your week by learning from the Word of God. It is so important, and we are so pleased to have you here. So the first thing we want to do, one of the most important things we do at Good News Club, is to review our memory verses. You might have got a little rusty. Were you practicing over Christmas break? Well, whether you were or whether you're not, we're going to get up now and sing the Word of God together. All right, teachers, of course, you're going to go ahead and share, making sure to share your computer sound, our memory verse video with music here, and it looks like I have it set. I'm going to go back to the beginning. Go ahead and play the songs one by one. Be sure to do the motions. Be energetic. Sing with them with the kids and watch them. It's a lot of fun. Encourage them to get up and move around. But just for the sake of time, I'm going to go ahead and skip going through that. But if you have taken a break too and forgot the motions, watch the video a couple times before you are ready to teach the lesson, so you're not kind of fumbling around while the kids are in your Good News Club. So we always want to do our homework before we show up at Good News Club. Now, it was brought up that we need to find a way to recognize our kids for the good things that they're doing, like attending, bringing their Bible, maybe wearing their t-shirts, and saying their memory verses. So talk to your team and figure out the best way to acknowledge your kids and the good work that they've done. For my team, we decided to put together a little PowerPoint, and I'll show it to you here, to acknowledge and congratulate the kids who've been doing a terrific job. And I will share this with you. If you want to use the format, feel free, and you can just fill in the names of your kids. All right, so at Good News Club, there's a few things that we want you to continue to work on every week. One of them is to say your memory verses. God tells us he wants us to hide his word in our heart, and the Bible says, so that we won't sin against the Lord. It's so important. Then we want you to bring your Bible. Now, I realize at Good News Club, there's so much going on. You may not have time to really open up your Bible and read, but we want you to get in the habit of having your Bible with you. Open it up in the morning, in the afternoon, or before you go to bed, and read God's word for yourself. And then you can't learn anything if you don't show up. So we're so glad that you're here. And we're going to acknowledge some of you who have done a terrific job. So congratulations, the teachers and I really appreciate you. Here is our list of kids who have perfect attendance. They haven't missed a single Good News Club, and we have been delighted to get to know them better and have fun learning the God's word with them. Now, for some of you who joined our club in the middle of the year, that's okay. We're delighted that you're here too. And we're gonna sort of start fresh with this in January. So show up on the first week that school is back in session, January 2021, and you can be back in the running for perfect attendance. And guys, it's on Zoom. So if you're sick, it doesn't matter. Zoom with us. We want to see you, even if you're blowing your nose. All right, those of you who brought your Bible, wow, we have a lot of kids who brought their Bible. Some of you brought it once or twice, and others have been bringing it every single time. So keep up the good work. And we want to acknowledge the kids who've been trying their very best to say their memory verses. We have a few kids who've said one or two, maybe three, but these kids said four out of the last five memory verses, and we're delighted. Alex, Daniel, and Andrew, good job. But let's get a round of applause for our kids who've said all five of their memory verses. That means that they haven't skipped a time, they try their best, and then they've been saying these terrific memory verses. It's a better gift than I can give you, having God's word in your heart. So congratulations to all the kids on your list. All right, so find some way to acknowledge your kids. Maybe you want to do a grab and go with prizes. Maybe you want to mail something to their house, whatever works for your club. But we want to make sure that they know that we're paying attention and keeping up with some of our normal things that we do. All right. Well, obviously, studying the Bible is important to us here at Good News Club. And the Bible is valuable to us because it's because God's word says that all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for rebuke and correction and training in righteousness. And in the Bible, we can find out more about who God is. And that's really important because in our lesson today, we want to remember who God is. That becomes really important in our story today. All right, I pause for a second because I want to share a screen. We have a wonder time here. And it's going to remind us that reading the Bible helps us remember who God is. The stories that are written down in this Bible tell us about the character and the power and the qualities of the God, the one true God. Now, I'm going to read you a few verses, and I want you to listen very carefully. There's a word in both of these verses that can help us figure out how we should think about the word of God. Listen up to this one. This is in Psalm 1, chapter 1, verse 2. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. And then I'm going to flip over to the book of Joshua, again, chapter 1, verse 8. Can you hear this word that starts with an M that's going to help us understand what God wants us to do with the Bible? It says, do not let this book of law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Wow, I would like to be prosperous and successful. So who heard the word? It started with an M and it tells us how we should use the Bible. Thank you. I heard somebody say it. Meditate. The Bible tells us that we are to meditate on the word of God. Now, I have kids in elementary school, and our school right now is doing these Monday morning assemblies that have a lot to do with meditation, but really they're teaching the kids to empty their minds of all their thoughts so that they're not distracted. That's how the world looks at meditation or to meditate. They think we need to empty and remove our thoughts so that we can focus, so that we can not be distracted. But that's not what the Bible says. When the Bible talks about meditating on the word of God, it actually means that we should be filling our mind with the word of God and thinking actively about what it says. So in the Bible, when we meditate on the word of God day and night, number one, we want to think about the word of God. Don't just repeat it over and over again. There is value in memorization, but think about what the word of God is saying. Number two, ask God to show you how you can use, how it can help you, or how it can help you, or how you can use it to help somebody else. It's my little tongue twister for the day. So how can God's word help you and help you to help other people? Think about that throughout your day. And finally, meditation can include praising God for the truth in his word and just being thankful that we have the Bible. So again, we want you to meditate on the word of God day and night, filling your mind with the word of God. So I want to ask some of our teachers to share some practical ideas about things that they do to meditate on the word of God. All right, so I went ahead and spotlighted each of the four teachers who help in my club. I told them in advance to be prepared, and they had some great ideas about the ways that they meditate on the word of God. One of our teachers talked about how she is trying to memorize an entire book of the Bible, and she goes over and over it. And she thinks about what it means. Another one said that she has a special quiet time set aside so that she can pray and read and study the Bible. And I shared that I like to print out Bible verses and stick them on the walls of my house and even in the bathroom where there's a captive audience. So as I'm walking throughout the house during the day, I can read God's word and it reminds me to stay focused and to meditate on him. So let's go ahead and go to breakout rooms. I want you to think about how you can meditate on the word of God, the Bible, day and night. So give us your best ideas. All right, so we broke our club into two groups. That's what we normally do. Do it however you do, together, take turns with the kids. But in some way, get them to share how they can interact and meditate on the word of God. Some of the kids had great ideas about Bible studies and youth groups that they go to. Others talked about waking up early in the morning and reading their Bible. And of course, many of them talk about praying at nighttime before they sleep. And we got to share with them some more ideas. It was really a beautiful time. And we just want to reinforce that one of our purposes here is to train these kids in righteousness, to train them in how to study the Bible and understand God's word. All right, well, there's another way that we can meditate on the word of God, and I didn't hear anyone say it, so it's one of my favorite ways, and that is to worship God through song. That can be a meditation. As you sing the words of the song, usually in worship songs, we're singing about the character of God, who he is, the great things that he has done for us, and the hope that we have because he has saved us from our sin. It's beautiful. So everybody, let's hop on up out of our chairs. I'm going to go ahead and share a video with you. I want to see you dancing and singing while we praise God and worship him for who he is. All right, let me see if this is still set up. So give me just a moment, teacher. Okie doke, here I'm ready. This week I picked the song, He is God, because it just, our verse today is about who God is, remembering who he is and understanding his character. So I think this is a terrific one. Again, I'm gonna skip it just for time's sake so you can have a shorter training video, but I'll share the YouTube link. Recently, CEF removed some of their song demonstrations from the public access website. So you'll need to get a CEF account in order to access these videos, or some of them are available on YouTube. I'll provide the YouTube link to you if needed. But in the future, if you want to have access to more videos, you're going to need to set up that account. We can talk about that more at Friday meetings. But this was a great one. He is God, the one true God. There's no doubt. I'm going to shout it out. And then it says, come and see what God has done and all the wonders under the sun. It was so fun to see my kids up there in their little squares dancing and singing and praising the Lord. It's a terrific one. But, you know, you can always make decisions about how much time you have. The lesson today is kind of long, and you want to make sure you have time for it. So if for any reason you think you're running out of time, go ahead and skip it for next time. And just mention that singing is a great way to meditate on the word of God. Oh boy. Okay, for those of you who remember way back several weeks ago, we started a story about Moses. But that story actually begins before that. It begins with the blessing and the promise that God gave to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He established the Israelite people, and he promised to be their God, that they would be his people, and that he would bless them. In fact, he promised that he would bless the whole world through the Israelites. And as time went on, though, it looked like there was a problem with this blessing, because we know that the Israelites ultimately became slaves in Egypt. I'll go ahead and show you some pictures from last week. And I updated the PowerPoint, teachers, so that you could have a quick review built in. So we know the Israelites had become slaves under the Egyptian Pharaoh. He made them work hard every day building his cities. And in fact, he noticed that there were so many of them that he did evil, terrible things and commanded that the little children would be thrown into the Nile River, so that they wouldn't have so many Israelites. They were afraid that they would overtake them. The Egyptians were afraid. And of course, this was terrible for the Egyptian families, and their new little babies would come and they'd have to find some way to keep them safe. And we know that one of these little babies was placed into a basket by his mother. She was trusting in God to protect that precious, beautiful baby. She knew God had a plan for his life. Sorry, I got a little interruption in the background. Some of them don't read the note on the door that says, don't come in right now. All right. So his mother put him into that same Nile River where the babies were being killed. But instead, she put her faith in God to protect her child. And little Moses was protected. He was drawn up out of the water by the princess of Egypt and raised in the palace as her own child, the heir to the throne. And as Moses grew, he became aware that not only did he have the special privilege of being raised in the Egyptian palace, but he also knew the one true living God. You see, his mother had taught him who God really is. And so one day when he was about 40 years old, he went to go see what was happening with his people, the Israelites. You see, and when he went there, Moses saw an Egyptian taskmaster beating an Israelite slave, and he became so enraged that he killed the Egyptian taskmaster. Any tongue twister problem today? Somehow he thought that the Israelites would back him up and support them, but instead they turned on him too and said, are you going to kill me too? And Moses had to flee from Egypt into the desert, where he became a shepherd, raised a family, and for 40 years, he probably thought that everybody had forgotten about him back in Egypt. But God had not forgotten about Moses. And so as we jump in our story today, let me just pop it in right here. The people, Moses is living as a shepherd. And one day he saw a bush that was on fire and burning, but it was not consumed, so it wasn't burning up. He went closer to see what it was. And when he did, the Lord spoke to Moses from that burning bush. Now, if you remember from way back in our first lesson, Moses offered up 5 different excuses to God about why he should not be the one to go to Pharaoh to say, let my people go. You see, God had a purpose and call for his life, but Moses was afraid. He didn't think that he could do this job. But the truth is, boys and girls, Moses couldn't do this job. Only God could. But with the power of God, the Bible says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But when Moses was thinking about his own ability, he said, oh, gosh, what if they don't believe me? I'm not a very good speaker. Maybe you should send somebody else. And finally, God said, no, Moses, you go, and I'll send your brother Aaron to go with you to tell the Pharaoh to let my people go, because I've heard the cry of Israel, and I am going to deliver them. Now, this is kind of fun. Some of you might remember that with all of Moses's objections, God stepped up every time and said, I'm going to provide for you. In fact, he provided miraculous signs that Moses could show to the Pharaoh to prove that God was the powerful creator of the whole world. So one of them was that Moses was to take his big rod that he used for shepherding the sheep. He kind of poked at them, throw it on the ground, and it would become, does anyone remember? Oh, a slithering snake. And so Moses dropped his rod on the ground, and it did. It became a snake. And then God said to him, Moses, there's more. I'll give you more proof that I am who I am. And so he said, take your hand, put it into your cloak in front of the Israelite leaders. And when you lift it out, oh, it's going to be diseased and leprous. Oh, doesn't it look terrible? We learned a little bit about what leprosy was like and how, like sin, it eats away at a person's body. People were so afraid of leprosy that they didn't want anything to do with somebody who had that problem. And so Moses was to take that leprous hand, put it back in his cloak, and when he brought it out, it would be clean. All right, teachers, if you have some of these fun tricks back in the day in your cabinet, go ahead and pull it out. I couldn't resist getting out my fun glove. If you don't, it's okay. Just tell the kids the story. The last proof that God gave to Moses was that he would turn the Nile into blood. And so with these miraculous signs from God and the command to go to the Pharaoh, Moses and Aaron set out to go to the palace to say to Pharaoh, let my people go. Now, on their way there, they decided to stop in and check in with the Israelite leaders. So now Aaron had been living in Egypt and the Hebrews knew him, but Moses had been gone for 40 years. Most people had forgotten about him. So when he came, he went to the leaders of Israel, told them what God had said, that he'd heard their cry and that he was going to deliver their people. And to prove it, he showed them those miraculous signs. The rod turned into a snake, the hand became leprous, and the Nile was turned to blood. And when they saw that, the Israelite people said, we're in. We can follow a God who can do these things. And so they sent Moses off to the Pharaoh to do these wonderful signs. Do you think Pharaoh was impressed by the miraculous signs that Moses and Aaron were able to do? Well, guess what? Pharaoh was not nearly as impressed as the Israelites had been. In fact, when he saw the snake slither around and the rod turn into a slithery snake, he said, I don't know about that. Let me see what he did. Let's see. Well, why don't I call my magicians and my wise men? And many of them were into witchcraft. He said, come here. Can you do that trick? I want to see if you can do it too. Now, boys and girls, the Bible tells us that the magicians in Pharaoh's court were able to turn rods into snakes. And so Pharaoh thought, why should I listen to this God that Moses is telling me about when my magicians and the gods that I worship, the false gods in Egypt, can do the same thing? But when the Egyptian magician snakes slithered around near Moses's snake, the one from God, Moses's snake opened its mouth and swallowed up those other snakes. Whoa! But Pharaoh wasn't impressed. And so finally, Moses warned Pharaoh that the Nile River would be turned into blood if he did not let the people go. But instead of saying yes, Pharaoh got angry. And he said, you Israelites are lazy. You're taking them away from their work. In fact, I'm going to make it harder for them. Now they have to make the bricks to build my buildings. And they have to collect, the straw as well. I'm not going to provide it for them anymore. And they need to make just as many bricks as they did before. So now the people of Israel, the Israelite slaves, their labor and their mistreatment was even worse than before. But hadn't Moses done what God had asked him to do? Didn't God say he was going to deliver these people? Well, boys and girls, the Israelites became angry and upset. Now, when you're hurt or angry or scared and upset, who should you go to? I think I see some of you saying the correct answer. We should go to God with all our fears and concerns. But that's not what they did. They went to Pharaoh. You see, they had been subjects or slaves to Pharaoh for so long that they still thought he was the authority. And sometimes in our lives, we've been so used to doing things our own way and sinning that we forget that God's the one who's really in control. And maybe we go to our friends, maybe we ask ourselves, we do everything except for go to the God who is the one true God. But when they complained to Pharaoh, he's just made their work harder. And so they bitterly complained to Moses and Aaron and saying, you should have never come here. You've made it worse for us. But I'm glad to tell you that Moses did the right thing. And Moses took his concerns to the Lord. And he cried out to the Lord and said, why have you done this? I've done what you said, but the Israelites are being treated worse than ever. And boys and girls, that's when in the book of Exodus chapter 6, God reminded Moses who he was. He told Moses that he would deliver the people. In fact, 7 times God says, I will deliver my people. I will show my power. He reminded Moses that the God he serves is the one true living God. And that no matter what things look like, we need to remember who God is and be obedient. Well, after that little pep talk, Moses returned to Pharaoh as the Lord had commanded him. And this time he showed the first of what would be 10 terrible plagues on Egypt if they would not let God's people go. And so on the PowerPoint slide, you'll see there's Aaron putting the rod into the water and the Nile is turning into blood. And here's just a quick little snapshot of some of the plagues that were to come. But I want to do it a different way. So if you can, teachers, this is the best way, I think. We have a great song at Good News Club, the plague song that will help you remember all the things, all the powerful things that God did to show who he is. All right. So when Moses went to Pharaoh and said, let my people go, Pharaoh refused. And then God sent plague number 1, turn the Nile into blood. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low, they told Pharaoh, let them go. Now, boys and girls, if the Nile turned into blood, can you imagine how stinky and disgusting the water would be? The Bible tells us that not only did the water turn into blood, but all the fish died. And then the people had no clean water to drink, and the animals had no clean water to drink, and they had nowhere to bathe. Oh, the Egyptians liked to be clean. So this was absolutely disgusting. The Nile turned into blood. Can you imagine? But still, the Pharaoh would not let the people go. So in fact, he called to those magicians, hey, guys, come here. So can you do the same thing? Now, I only had one Hawaiian punch packet, but if you can do it with your kids, they loved it. I had an empty glass with the Hawaiian punch powder at the bottom. And I just kind of put my hand over so you couldn't see it. And then I took a clean pitcher of water and I poured it in. And as you pour, the water will turn red and it looks like it's turning into blood. So I don't have it to do it again, but I think you can all figure it out. And then you can kind of hold it for a little bit. Can you imagine going for a clean drink of water? Oh, it's blood. The Bible says they had to dig around the sides of the Nile to get fresh water to drink. It was disgusting. But those magicians that Pharaoh called, they could do the same thing. And in fact, I think I skipped an important part. All right, I keep getting interrupted by my kiddos today, but so I think I left something out. When the Pharaoh called his magicians and they could do the same things, let's talk about that a little bit, because does it make sense to you that they could do the same thing that God could do miraculously? Well, at first, it doesn't make that much sense to me, but let's think about it. Now, if you've ever gone to a magic show and you've seen them do things like pull a rabbit out of a hat, or play, you do a card trick and pull the correct card out. What you've seen is a trick, and it's a sleight of hand. They found some way to slip the card back in the deck, and you pick it, and wow, that's really cool. But it's not magic. So one thought is that the magicians in Egypt had ways to do tricks, that they were tricky. Maybe they hid snakes inside rods, and then they cracked it open, and the snake slithered out. We don't know. But more likely, the magicians got the power to do these same tricks because they were worshiping the false gods, which is really worshiping Satan, God's enemy. And the Bible tells us that God has given some authority to Satan here on earth. And so there are, he can do things that seem miraculous to us, but only what God allows. And you'll see what happens as the plagues continue. So those magicians, they could make more water turn into blood. But let me ask you, is that what the Egyptian people needed? Ugh, more blood? No, what did they need? And of course, I asked my kids and they knew. That's right, they needed to turn the blood back into fresh drinking water. So really, they weren't doing anything to help. But the Pharaoh was convinced that he would be more powerful than this God that Moses kept bringing up. And so he would not let the people go. So then God sent plague number two, jumping frogs all over you. All the people in Egypt feeling very low. They told Pharaoh, let them go. All right, I think that frogs somehow sound adorable and cute in fairy tales. But if you had frogs crawling in your bed and frogs jumping into your bread so that when you cut a slice of bread for a sandwich, ugh, maybe you got some frog leg in there too. Not so cute. And the Bible tells us that the frogs were everywhere all over Egypt and in the areas where the Hebrew slaves were. And people would open up their jars and cabinets and find frogs. Ugh. Can you imagine? Well, the Pharaoh did not like this at all. And he cried out to Aaron and Moses and he said, oh, make it stop. You know, and then Moses said, well, when would you like it to stop? And of course, I would have said right away, but he said tomorrow. So Moses prayed to God and the frogs stopped the next day. But you know, it would still be left all over the ground. Dead frogs. Now, years ago, I was watching a news story, a very unusual news story, where they'd had this bizarre growth of frogs in a local area. And they took a picture of a boy biking down the street to go to school. And as he biked, there were so many frogs on the sidewalk that he would just crunch right over them on his way to school. Ooh, I'll never forget the sound of those frogs. Well, when the frogs were gone and the people got relief, Pharaoh, who had sounded like maybe he was going to change his mind, immediately said, nope, I'm not going to let them go. And so God said, wait, there's more. Then God sent plague number three, swarms of gnats from head to knee. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, let them go. All righty. So in this one, The rod of Moses and Aaron touched the ground, and the dust became flying little gnats. Oh, the kind that buzz in your ear and bug you, and you swat at them, and they may be there biting at you. This summer in my backyard, we had mosquitoes, and just a couple mosquitoes were so irritating that I didn't want to be out there anymore. Can you imagine if swarms and clouds full of gnats were all over the land? Well, this is the one that finally, when Pharaoh called his magicians and said, "Can you do that too?" They couldn't do this one. And the magician said to Pharaoh, "This is the finger of God." They couldn't do this. Apparently, God had stopped the power of the magicians to do these same miraculous things. And now the Lord was saying, "I'm not going to let you go any further." And the gnats swarmed all over people. Well, Pharaoh still wouldn't let the people go. So, and then God sent plague number four. Filthy flies, need we say more? All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, "Let them go." Now, starting from plague number four on, something amazing happened. God decided that the plagues would be upon Egypt, but not on the Israelites. So the area where the Israelites lived was the land of Goshen, and those flies did not go to the land of Goshen. So the Israelites were living comfortably while the Egyptian people were covered in flies. Oh, if I have just one fly in my house, I'm irritated all day until I can get it. And I'm reminded that years ago, I went on a mission trip to Kenya and I spent some time with people who lived in houses that were made of dung. Now, boys and girls, dung is a nice word for poop. And what do flies like? Zzz, they love poop. And so in this little village, even though it didn't smell because the dung was dried out and turned into these bricks to build their homes, the flies were attracted to their houses. And there would be so many flies on the houses, on the animals, and on the faces of the people that there was never a time when there weren't flies crawling over everybody. In fact, the little babies, I remember they'd be held in their mother's arms and they were too small and the flies would be crawling into their eyes and into their noses. Oh, it was difficult to watch, but the people there had gotten used to it. But I'm telling you, Pharaoh wasn't used to it. He did not like it and he wanted those flies gone. But could his magicians get rid of the flies? No, they couldn't, because boys and girls, God is in control. Then God sent plague number five. All the livestock up and died. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, "Let them go." When this happened, all the goats and the sheep and the cattle and the donkeys in the area of Egypt died. Now, this was a big deal because those animals were not only food, but some of them provided milk and others were their work animals, and now they were gone. But what was happening over where the Israelites live? God's hand of protection was on them. Remember, he promised to be their deliverer and he was keeping his promise. And so they had animals and the Egyptians did not. Now, still, Pharaoh would not let them go. So you know what's going to happen next to the tune of "This Old Man." Here we go. Then God sent plague number six, boils and sores to make you sick. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, "Let them go." Now, number six particularly afflicted the magicians. These men who stood up and acted like they could do what God could do, the ones who were starting to realize that they were dealing with a God that was not like any God that they'd ever spent time with before. He was the one true God. And those boils and sores, which are like cuts and wounds all over your body, were so terrible that the Bible tells us the magicians couldn't stand in the presence of Moses and Aaron. Oh, they had to sit down or lay down because they were in such terrible pain. And we believe that God was putting a particular punishment on them because they had misled the people into worshiping false gods. But do you think Pharaoh's going to let the people go? Nope. Then God sent plague number seven, hail and lightning down from heaven. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, "Let them go." Now, some of you have been in storms or seen hail. But this hailstorm, the Bible tells us, was not like any storm you've ever seen. It was so terrible and ferocious that people were killed during this plague, people and animals, anything that was left outside, except in the land of Israel. Now, there were, the Bible tells us, some Egyptians at this point who feared the Lord. They knew they were dealing with a God who could really do, had the power to do what he said. And so through those Egyptians who feared the Lord, the Bible says they brought their animals under shelter. They brought in their slaves and their family members to hide them in their house, and they were saved. But anyone who did not fear the Lord, who did not take the warning to protect themselves, they were killed or harmed, and their animals were killed. Now, God does this for us too. You know, we're under a warning. Our sin is causing us great problems, and God's warning us that judgment is coming. He always does warn us. And if we obey God and listen to his commands, we are saved, just like the Egyptians. Now, on number 7, Pharaoh said something very interesting. He called in Moses and Aaron, and he said, "Oh, I have sinned." He said, "You know, I have sinned. Pray to God for me and, give us relief." But the Bible tells us that Pharaoh didn't really fear the Lord. Have you ever met somebody who apologized, said they were sorry, said, "Oh, please pray for me," but they really didn't mean it? Well, boys and girls, God sees the heart. He knows if we're serious or not. He knows if we are truly repentant or not. And he knew that Pharaoh did not actually want to repent. So then God sent plague number 8. Locusts came and they sure ate all the people in Egypt, feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, "Let them go." All right. Can anyone think of another word for locust? Maybe another little creature you can think of? Somebody said it, grasshoppers. So if you've ever seen cute little grasshoppers, this is different. This is a massive cloud, a moving army of little munching, crunching bugs that can wipe out an entire crop and harvest within hours. And that's what happened. They came upon the area of the Egyptians and they wiped out all their food supply and ate it up. Now, these terrible plagues were causing great, great harm to the Egyptian people. And they began to cry out to Pharaoh and beg him to let these people go and to relent from these terrible plagues. But Pharaoh's heart was hardened. The Bible tells us that his heart was hardened and he refused to listen to the Lord. Now, we can have a hard heart sometimes too. We can refuse to listen to God. We don't want to do that. We always want to keep our heart tender and sensitive. Remember, one of our memory verses says, "Be kind to one another, tender hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you." We want to be tender hearted. So if you've done the wrong thing and God's warning you, telling you bad news is coming, listen, have a soft heart. But the Bible tells us Pharaoh's heart wasn't soft. It was hardened to the Lord. So then God sent plague number 9, total darkness all the time. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. They told Pharaoh, "Let them go." Now, some of you might be afraid of the dark, but can you imagine total darkness all the time for 3 days? That's what happened in this plague. Now, if we get up in the middle of the night and the house is dark, we might think that's total darkness, but it's not. Because I'm telling you, somewhere in your house, there's a clock on that's giving off a little light, or maybe the light of the moon is coming through your window. Oh, my recording paused for a second. Or perhaps the street lights are on, or there's a little night light in your house. But this was total darkness all the time. And the Bible says that for 3 days, the Egyptians could not move from their homes to go anywhere because they couldn't see. And they were terrified of this God who has control over all things. Would the Pharaoh finally let them go? Well, boys and girls, the Bible says that the Pharaoh said, "Okay, you can go. But let's see. But he put a few restrictions on them." He did this a couple of times. First he said, "Oh, just the men. And then he said, oh, don't take the animals. And finally, he changed his mind and said, no, you're not going to go. You see, Pharaoh didn't want to let go of his control over these people. And this was really a battle between good and evil, between Satan and God, between darkness, total darkness all the time, and light. What do you think is going to win? Well, the final plague was the most terrible of all. And after this plague, the Pharaoh would let God's people go. God would triumph and make his people free. But not before Pharaoh's son and all the firstborn children in Egypt died. In plague number 10, God warned the people and he warned the Pharaoh that all the firstborn sons would die, including even the animals firstborn, unless they obeyed the Lord. If they wanted to be safe, God gave them specific instructions about how they could be protected against this last plague of death. So let's sing together. Then God sent plague number 10. Pharaoh's son died, so he gave in. All the people in Egypt feeling pretty low. Finally, Pharaoh let them go. Boys and girls, Pharaoh let the Israelite people go, but not until every house in Egypt was filled with weeping and mourning and crying, including his own. His own son was killed in this final plague. And finally, not only did he tell them that they could go, but he pushed them out and said, go, leave me here. Now, what happened to the Israelite people? God had protected them from plagues 4 through 9 so far. Would he protect them from this final plague? Well, I'm delighted to tell you that God offered a way, a delivery, a way to be safe from this final plague. He instructed the Israelite people to take a little lamb, a perfect little lamb, to sacrifice it and kill it and put its blood on the door of their homes. And then they would take that little lamb and they would eat dinner together. And at midnight, while the family is safe inside eating, the angel of the Lord would pass over and any house that had the blood of the lamb on its doorposts would be safe. And any house that did not, those houses that did not heed God's warning, the ones that did not obey the Lord, in their homes, death came. But the people of Israel rejoiced the next day when they woke up and their children were alive, when they realized that the Lord had passed over them and spared them from this final plague of suffering. And in fact, that meal that they ate is repeated over and over again in Jewish families and in Christian families who want to remember that God provides a way of salvation, that he offers deliverance. We can remember who God is. He is the God who saves, the God who offers forgiveness, the God who rescues us from our sin and delivers his people. So that is our wonderful story today. Okay, so that was our wonderful story from the Bible. And I want to talk a little bit more about why the Bible is so amazing, why we want to meditate on it day and night. And we can find out more about who God is by reading the Bible in our memory verse for today. But first, I want to share with you some really cool information about why we can know that the Bible is reliable. All right. One of the greatest discoveries happened in 1947 in caves near the Dead Sea in the area that's Israel and Jordan. People who were discovering down there found thousands of parchment scrolls, which were copies of the original Bible. Now, the Bible wasn't written down in bound books like we have it today. It was originally written on parchment papers and rolled up. And when they found this discovery, what they were able to do is compare it to our current Old Testament and found that it was identical to the Bible that we have today, which means that the Bible is accurate, right? It's consistent over thousands of years. In fact, these scrolls called the Dead Sea Scrolls are about 2,000 years old. Now, we often study really terrific documents from history, like the Declaration of Independence, for example, and there's only a few copies of that available, but that document is only about 250 years old, and we trust its reliability. The Bible is the same and reliable over thousands and thousands of years. And it's amazing when we think about it being the most reliable historical document. Now, one of these Dead Sea Scrolls had multiple pieces of different books from the Bible, but it had the entire book of Isaiah. The entire book from the beginning to end of Isaiah was included in these scrolls. And our verse today comes from the book of Isaiah. So can I have a student read this for us? It's good to get the students involved whenever you can. So I had a student read, "I am the Lord and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God." And that's from the book of Isaiah in the Bible, which is just about in the middle of the Bible, 45 verse 5. And then I had a student read, "I am the Lord and there is no other. Beside me, there is no God," Isaiah 45, 5a. And here it is. So let's go ahead and learn the motions for our verse. Ready? I am the Lord, one hand up at a time, pointing to the sky. I am the Lord. And then we're going to cross our hands, shake our head, no. And there is no other. And then cross your arms, beside me, there is no God. Like you're pushing those arms aside. Isaiah 45, verse 5a. Wow, that's not too hard. You can totally do it. And I'm so proud of you guys for learning all your memory verses. Let's do it again. I am the Lord and there is no other. Beside me, there is no God. Isaiah 45, verse 5. All righty. And then we watched the music clip. I'm going to skip that again for today for time, but use it with the kids. Play the video from CEF. It's in your attachments and it's a terrific resource. All right, and then if you have time, and I don't know if you will, we did a very simple review game, but actually the kids had a lot of fun. I had another teacher with me, Miss Diane, and Diane would act out one of the different parts of the verse using the motions like charades, and the kids would guess which part of the verse she's acting out. And you don't have to use this PowerPoint, but if you want to, we're going to do, "I am the Lord, and there is no other. Beside me, there is no God," little g, not the big G, there's only one God. Isaiah 45, verse 5. All right, so then you can have a student, pick a student, and then have your teacher, whoever it is, act out. All right, so can you guys switch what I'm doing? Ready? Let's see. Anyone want to guess? And there is no other. Very good. Okay, I'm going to do another one. Ready? I am the Lord. Very good. And here's our another one. Ready? Who knows what this one is? And you take your time and ask the kids, and they have fun playing our little charades. This is Isaiah 45, verse 5. And last one. Beside me, there is no God. You got it. All right, let's put it all together. We did it again. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Beside me, there is no God. Isaiah 45, verse 5. You got it. Good job. All right. If you have time, listen to the kids to the memory verse, have a couple of them demonstrate it. And that's a great way to reinforce the lesson too, the lesson and the memory verse. All right. Okay. Now I've taught this twice in a single day, so I can tell my voice is going and I had to make a stop in between to drop off kids. So hopefully this is all one cohesive lesson for you guys, but I know you guys are going to do a terrific job. When I'm with the kids in Good News Club, it's really fun because you get feedback from them, there's questions, you get a chance to really tell a story. So I hope you guys are having as much fun as I am with my Good News Club kids. A couple of hot tips I wanted to tell you. I wanted to remind myself of some of the important points for each of the plagues. So I put a little note on the backside, a little sticky note. So you might've noticed me doing one of these things because I was looking, like for example, and turn the Nile into blood. I just want to remind myself that the magicians could do that as well, that the fish died, it stank, there was no water even in the buckets and jars, and they had to dig around the Nile. So I put little notes like that, especially, you know, for example, like number four, that's when the plagues were no longer on the Israelites. So I put a little note on the back. So that's one of the benefits of Zoom is that it's very easy to have little reminders close by to keep you on track. So for example, we're going to go on to our missionary story, and I have the missionary story written out right here. All right, so a few weeks ago, when we began a new missionary story, We talked about what is a missionary. So can anyone answer that question? What's a missionary? And the kids answered, well, you're right. A missionary is somebody who goes to tell other people about Jesus, the good news of Jesus. So you can be a missionary in other countries, and you can be a missionary right at home, when wherever you are, if you're talking to people about who God is, right? And we want to remember who God is. You know, in our story today, the Israelites used the Passover meal as a reminder to them throughout the generations of who God is and how powerful he is. So we want to do the same thing, meditate on the word of God, remember who God is. So when we began this year, we told you a wonderful story about an amazing missionary. What was the name of our very first missionary that we talked about at Good News Club? That's right, it was Johnny Erickson Tata. That was a wonderful story. And we've begun a new lesson series with a new missionary. Can anyone remember his name? It's been a couple weeks. All right, if you guessed Abner Pineda, you are correct. So we're going to find out more about Abner Pineda, who is a missionary to tell people about Jesus around the world. Now, one of the fun things about being able to do this with a team is that there's somebody else who can do your PowerPoint for you if you need to. So I'm sort of like walking and chewing gum at the same time here, and sometimes doing it more effectively than others. For example, right now, for some reason, my screen share is not working. So I'm going to go back in and see if I can find, oh no, there it is, the Pineda slide. So here we go. So this is Abner Pineda, and he is a missionary, and that's his wife. But we're going to go back a little in time and talk about Abner when he was a little boy, about the age of some of you here. When he was first born, Abner was born not in a hospital, but in a church, in the church where his father was the pastor. The cry of this little baby boy pierced the cool night air in the town of Santa Rosa de Copan in Honduras. And that is one of the countries here in Central America. Can you guys see where my pointer is? That is Honduras, where Abner was born. As Abner grew older, here we are, he loved to play soccer and marbles and all kinds of games with his friends Rene, Osvaldo, and Carlos. The boys enjoyed making slingshots from small branches of the guava tree, pieces of leather and a long rubber band, and they used them to practice shooting things for fun. Now, my helper grabbed a slingshot that she had for one of her kids. If you have that for show and tell, that'd be terrific. Otherwise, you can show this slide. When Abner was 8 years old, he liked going to church on Sunday with his friends. He especially liked his Sunday school teacher, Mrs. Vigil. One Sunday, the children were coloring a picture of heaven, and Mrs. Vigil said that only Christians who believe in Jesus could color in that picture. Well, this made Abner think, am I a Christian? After all, he had been born in the church, literally born in a church. Does that make him a Christian? No, it doesn't. And then he thought about his father. His parents were Christians. His father was a pastor. Would that make Abner a Christian? Some of you have Christian parents. They've decided to follow Jesus, but does that mean that that decision counts for you too? No. Even if your mother and father are Christians, you must make your own decision to trust in Jesus as your Savior. Abner knew that he was a sinner. He also knew that Jesus came to earth to die on the cross to pay for everyone's sins, including Abner's. He prayed with Mrs. Vigil right there and trusted Jesus as his Savior. Now he was a Christian. There was one day of the year that Abner and his friends were most excited for, the annual festival Festival de Santa Rosa. It was the most exciting time of the year, and Abner and his friends could hardly wait. There would be Ferris wheels, games, parades, horses, and rodeos. It would be so much fun. Wow, we could really look forward to something like that, wouldn't we? Abner closed his eyes and imagined the sweet taste of cotton candy melting in his mouth. He would have so much fun with Carlos and Osvaldo and Renee. They'd run through the crowds, and he imagined winning the prize and ringing the bell toss game. Abner's friends talked of nothing else for weeks. I'm going to win the biggest prize, Carlos bragged. I'm going to hit the most targets in the target shooting game, said Osvaldo. But Abner's excitement was dampened when he thought about asking his parents for the money. You see, he knew that his parents would not give him money for things that were not important. There were 7 people in Abner's family, and his parents worked very hard for the little money they had. They had to spend it carefully. And I'm sure some of you know that your parents are working hard to make sure that you have what you need. They don't have extra money to spend either. But he started thinking, I know where mother keeps a little change, he thought. It won't hurt if I just take some change. They might not even notice if it's gone, and then I can play games with my friends. What will Abner do? Will he steal the money from his mother, or will he do the right thing? Boys and girls, you're going to have to come back next week to find out what Abner decided to do. But I'm so glad once again that you came today. Congratulations to you who won the Memoryverse Awards. Thank you for coming to hear our amazing story. Isn't God amazing? This week, I want you to remember who God is and meditate on his word day and night. Remember, don't empty your brain. Fill it with the goodness of God. All right, everybody, have a great week, and we'll see you soon. Bye. Thanks for coming to Good News Club.